I do expect there is over 100 of people here, and particularly most of you is young ladies. Okay, I get a little bit nervous. But anyway, okay, first of all, are you all coming from the construction department, or are you all coming from the studying quantity surveys? Yes, all are quantity surveyors in the future, right? And I have been working as a quantity surveyor for over 3 or 4 decades, okay? It's not a lot, I'm still young, but I have already been working as a construction industry for so many years. The day you have not given birth, I would say. Okay, so thank you very much. Today we would like to share some experience in Hong Kong, how we implement BIM, and a very long name, just share with you how BIM is applied in Hong Kong, okay? And I would also like to know how BIM is used in Malaysia too. I attend a conference every year in Malaysia, in KL, on the BIM implementation by RICS. They said that Malaysia is trying to catch up with the BIM implementation. Hello, good morning. Okay, so let's start with my presentation. And how long will I have? 1.5 hours? Right? Okay, I hope you all don't get asleep. Okay, this is my topic today, the experience survey of implementation and application of building information modeling in Hong Kong. And we are now talking about technology. Let's use some technology. Do you have an iPhone or whatever, Android phone? You can have my name card there. You can just scan the QR code and do it, and then you get my name card. Can you do that? So what is the purpose of this? Just because my PowerPoint contains a lot of website, a lot of things, people now are too lazy to type in the website address, right? We just scan the QR code and get the information, okay? So anyone get my name card here? Can you do that? Okay. Okay, I'm traveling from Hong Kong, just in case people don't know where is Hong Kong, because it's over there. Okay? I traveled 3.5 hours there, right? And that is Hong Kong, okay. I just worry that some of them may not know where is Hong Kong and what it is. Okay? And we got the two, we got a twin tower too, but all across the harbor, right? You get a twin tower close together, we got a twin tower. The most tallest building in Hong Kong, but they separate apart in different parts of the tower. With the same name, I would say. Both of them called the International Financial Center. This one and that one. And then you may say in Hong, you may see in Hong Kong, that is the world without BIM. You can see some photo from London. They said they have a very tall building, a very interesting building in different form, right? But in Hong Kong, all buildings are square, round, and typical, no feature at all, right? Unlike your twin tower, there's no features, no thing. Do you know what the reason why in Hong Kong is such boring? You know, just because of quantity surveyors, you know. All quantity surveyors try to reduce the cost, try to maximize the profit of the developer. That's why they cut all the features, they did all the building like this. All the buildings are square, a little bit round, and this is the same, right? All buildings look the same. I like your twin towers, it's a very interesting one. Okay, this is my qualification. I studied 4 master's degrees and 2 bachelor's degrees. And I just have a diploma in quantity surveying. So I'm not good in quantity surveying, but I'm good in mathematics, I'm good in computer science. So don't ask me so much quantity surveying things, okay? And I got some qualification in professional institution, fellow membership in Hong Kong IS, fellow membership in RICS. And there is an institute in Hong Kong called Hong Kong Institute of Building Information Modeling. And also an institute called Building Smart, which is related to what I'm talking about, is a about BIM. And also there is an institute for BIM professional. BIM professional means building environmental assessment method. It is green building assessment method. So, so I'm a member of it, and some environmental institutes. And I'm also a member of British Computer Society, Statistical Society, that is about computing as well. Okay, this is my company. I work for a company called Q&S. So people always misunderstand that this is me, quantitative surveillance. No, wrong, this is wrong. It's quantitative and scientific. What a very big name, I'm saying. Quantitative and scientific. We would like to do construction, or I like to do quantitative survey in a quantitative and scientific way. We try to use more technology. We try to use more quantitative way, I would say mathematical modeling and computer science, etc. So my main business, as you say, you can see, is about BIM, BIM plus quantitative surveying and risk management. So this is the website of my company. And you can see it's a BIM model. And the company is funded by myself, by my colleague, Andy is here right there, and also some of my team members. You know, in Hong Kong, people are getting a lot of professional qualifications. They try to prove themselves at the first beginning. When you give the name card to a person, they see your qualification and they have no doubt that they're to you at all. When people see me like this, they just think, oh, he's just a young guy with a nice suit, nothing off, nothing else, right? So when you get Hong Kong, like go to Hong Kong, try to write as much as possible. So I would say it's an all and sock bomb. You get a bomb that, oh, this is my qualification, I know everything. So please give me some business at the end, right? Okay, and this is our company. I founded in 2016, just a new company. And we all developer experience, and our mission is trying to create value to my client with our professional skill. And this is our business. Do you know we purposely arrange the letter BQR into such order so people can be remembered it. In Cantonese, I think some of them may know some Cantonese. 叉烧饭, we know BBQ rice means BBQ pork with rice, right? 叉烧饭. So my business is very, very, very simple, very easy to remember. We sell BBQ prompt, BBQ rice, okay? We sell building information modeling, building environmental assessment methods, quantitative surveying and risk management, okay? So in Hong Kong, you try to relate something, it's simple and easy, okay? Keep things simple and stupid, okay? BBQ rice, okay? Maybe in Malaysia, you sell laksa, it's okay, L-O-K-S-A, right? Something like this, so people can remember it. That's a way of marketing, right? Okay, for building information modeling, let's share our experience. Okay, in the past, I was a cost and quality controller in property developer. I have been working for over 20 years as a cost and quality controller in the developer. My duty includes mainly for cost control, and also include quality control, environmental control, green building certifications, warehouse management, and internal control. So that's why the building from my company become very boring. So people try to trim out, not people, it's myself, try to trim out everything, try to control everything, to keep everything simple to maximize the company benefits, right? And then at that time, I just realized that there is a potential for BIM just because of the graph, because of this figure. So when people talking about property development, talk about project management, they always refer to these figures that at the time you are having the concept design, having the preliminary design, you can make whatever change you like, right? The cost of change is very slow, very low. And then it will increase along with the time of the development. So at the end of commissioning or at the stages of construction, the cost to train becomes very large, right? It's an easy concept. And then the effectiveness of change. At the beginning of the project, you can change everything very effectively. You just just throw out, throw the paper into the in rubbish bin, and then you can redraw your whole design at the beginning of the project. And along with the time, you can't change everything because something is built on site, right? So there is a crossing point along which is somewhere along with the construction stage. So with the introduction to BIM, we will try to put everything at the beginning. We can do development appraisal with BIM, with BIM. We can do the design and cost control with the BIM, right? We can do it so that we can save some cost. So I believe it is true that then we ask our company to join the BIM family to try to use the BIM from 2010. So after a year, we got an award from Hong Kong Autodesk. Autodesk Hong Kong. And in the second year, 2012, we got another award in BIM. And in the third year, we also got an award in BIM award. So, but it is very easy to get such an award. You just buy the software and pay some conference fee, okay? Anyway, but it is a good starting point to let people know you are doing BIM in Hong Kong. At least you have some exposure, and if you can promote your company that you are now using the technology for your development. So people will think, oh, your company is getting a new technology to improve the quality, to enhance the green features, etc., etc. Okay, there is some photo image of the project I involved. And in particular, you see, we use BIM to try to stimulate the advertisement board, which is very huge in Hong Kong. We try to advertise the event, and eventually we find that only two sides of that is effective for the advertisement. So we delete the rest of the advertisement. And it is not the last version. I think the last version is originally we think all four directions should have advertisement like this. It's an LED panel. So finally, being a QS, being a cost controller, I think the last one is like this, a small gray one. We all trim down all the non-effective ones. We try to, it's a blue one, I think. The last version is that we only adopt the LED panel in this direction. All three directions are not so effective in advertising. Okay, and the second one is the residential development in the hillside. So we try to use BIM to model it. And also it's a very small building in Hong Kong. We use the same technology to model it. And this is a large development in Hong Kong. We use the BIM for modeling. And particularly effective when we are calculating the total GFA. The architect always asks us the question how they can maximize the GFA. So we encourage them to use BIM so that we can have a design change whenever we like, but still maximize the GFA. You know, when we are calculating the maximum GFA in such a large development, it takes about weeks and months for the architect to do so. But with the use of BIM, it is okay. We take several hours to cater for it. Okay, this is a general application. We use it for clash analysis, headroom clearance checking, external facade design studies, foundation and site formation studies, construction sequencing, feasibility studies for land building and quantity takeoff. Okay. For example, we use for feasibility studies. So in the past, we just got a 2D drawing from the architect, and my boss always asked us to produce a cost estimate or a land building cost estimate for them within several days. But suddenly, they will give you different options, option one and option two. So our in-house BIM modeler, with the technology, we can produce the model in several hours, and then we can see the actual image of the model to help us to do the estimate. And also it's very, very good at using the BIM for the pricing of the housing, you know, the pricing of the development. And you can see in the 2D drawing, we don't know whether there is a hill and how high the hill will affect the development. So we use the model, we can know all these topographic information. And this is important, you know, when doing estimate feasibility studies, actually the construction cost is nothing. In Hong Kong, actually, we're doing the construction cost for feasibility studies is a waste of time. I would say you can just use your thumb to say a figure for it. Because the pricing is more important than the construction cost in Hong Kong. You sell the property at a very high price in order to get your profit. You don't need to reduce any construction cost at all. You just try to finish the building as soon as fast as possible so that you can get the profit from the development. So and the pricing of the development is highly affected by their view. So if there is a very high hillside here and the threat is facing the hillside, the price will decrease in a very significant way. Okay, this is a joke from an engineer. When we do the feasibility studies, they just give us a figure. They just give us a figure like this. We put all the figures into the models, and the engineer finally realized that they said something wrong. I think in the future, when you are a clinician, where you always have received some advice from engineer, they said how long is the piling and how many piling will be needed for the development. And the engineer will never admit that they give you wrong information. They just tell you that you allow too much cost for the model, you allow too much item in your estimate, and then we draw the model. The first one and the second one, we tell them, you see the model, if you can get approval of this model, we do the estimate, follow either one, it's okay. And after that, we give them, he said, oh, this is the wrong information, maybe it give a zero behind the figure, maybe they calculate something. So actually the requirement for the piling is just a quarter of the original one, and the figures tell all evidence. So in the future, for a quantitative surveyor, if you don't want to be brave that you exaggerate the estimate or you allow too much cost for a project, you try to draw something for the engineer, for the architect. They it's better than you say 1,000 words. The architect and the engineer, they will shut up when they see the drawings from the quantitative surveyors, okay? They are very surprised that how come a quantitative surveyor can draw drawings that they cannot be drawn, you know? But, you know, I experienced that recently when we have BIM, and the quantitative surveyor can draw a 3D model for engineer, for architect comments, or for them to make some collaborations. But architect and engineer, instead, they try to use their amount of words, they try to talk instead of drawing something. So this is a good opportunity for all of you to try to improve the communication, to improve the collaboration by using the BIM model instead of writing something, okay? And this is also a feasibility of a foundation, visualization of a foundation, and we try to give some assistance to the engineer how they can do an excavation estimate, a preliminary foundation estimate. So all these models are drawn by quantitative surveyors, not engineer and not architect. And also we use the model for crash detection and at the detail stage. So you can see it's obviously there is some manhole crash into the foundation wall. And also the same thing, some main pipe pass through the main structural wall. And also when we are preparing the build of quantity, nowadays we are not going to issue the 2D tender query for them. We issue the 3D tender queries when we have the BIM model. We draw all the model into all the drawings into a model, and then we demonstrate that there's something wrong, something not drawn correctly. this is column 2. The column is shifting from a little bit from the lower floor, right? And also there is also the technical reason for the water tank. The water tank does not cater for the beam underneath the floor slab. Okay, the most interesting one. We use the beam model to do the quantity takeoff. We are very successful in using BIM for taking off the concrete tiles. So actually there's no more need to take off for the concrete tiles at all. Not including reinforcement. So I think one of your assignments may do a taking off for the concrete, measure all the concrete formwork and reinforcement from 2D drawings or from a model. And with our technology, we can do it by a computer, just a click. Okay, just very easy to use. So do you have a worry that all our quantity surveyor will be disappear in the future? No more measurement at all. We just replace it by the computer. maybe I will say maybe. Okay. And there's more important case when we are doing the excavation. Quantity surveyor in the past, they are very proud that they can measure everything. They can calculate every irregular shape. After I studied a lot of mathematics computers, I still don't understand how to calculate the volume of excavation from this to this in 2D drawings. How can we calculate? We use the Simpson rule of the calculus of the integration or differentiation formula to calculate. Or we use some approximation to calculate it. Actually, it's no way to calculate this accurately, right? It's irregular, there's no formula to calculate. We use approximation, right? But if we have the beam model, we can just calculate in a very simple way to have an accurate answer. So we, in Hong Kong, I don't know where there is such cases in Malaysia. In Hong Kong, there are a lot of disputes regarding the volume of excavation. They put it in arbitration and put it in litigation, and the court even don't know how to measure this accurately by the quantity surveyor. Quantity surveyor sometimes acts as an expert witness for the court. Right? So they submit expert witness report. They try to prove that the quantity measure is correct. Particularly in the dispute of the excavation volume. So with this technology, I think there will be a hope that we will have a more accurate measurement of the concrete volume. Not concrete volume, the excavation volume. So solve a lot of dispute. And people are now trying to put this technology into court and see whether it is acceptable or not. Okay, so why I just resigned from a developer as a cost controller and to become an entrepreneur in a new company? Just because we see the trend of BIM, we see the trend of building information modeling with the application of quantity surveys. So I still be a quantity surveyor, but we try to adopt technology. And in Hong Kong, there is a public policy in 2017. So there is a policy address, although it's just a little line in 103.30, so a long report policy, we just have a line about BIM. But this is very, very encouraging that the Hong Kong government is now realizing that BIM is very important. They said building information modeling allow construction professionals to carry out design and construction work in a virtual environment. Would help avoid changes, right? When the design is completed, so no more changes. Do you agree that? No. I think changes is the change, avoid changes from the default or from the incompleteness of the design. But you can't avoid changes from the market, right? In Hong Kong, they also usually change a lot of things due to the market change rather than the design change. So when you are building a residential building, Sometimes they change the location of the bathroom, sometimes they change the kitchen, they change the finishing, they change everything, just try to cope with the market, rather than the design thought by the engineer. So, but EIM can, in certain extent, avoid changes from incomplete design due to the engineer or architect fault, right? And then it can reduce risk, right? We manage the risk by BIM and render clarity to project cost. And this is very important, that government statement is always very accurate. When people ask you what is the benefit of BIM, you should never say that it saves cost. It will not save cost. BIM cannot reduce any cost at all. But it can render the clarity to the project, render clarity to the project cost. When people use the BIM, they can know the cost earlier, they can reduce the error, and they know everything in the earlier stage, and the TOS do the estimate more accurately. It cannot save cost, you know. It's just a calculator. When you use a calculator, will you save cost when you solve it? When you solve it with a calculator, you can save a lot of cost? No. Right? This is the same thing. When you use BIM, you cannot save your cost, but you will very clear that all the cost sensitive item, all the information required for the estimate, for the budgeting is in place so that you can do a more accurate estimate. Okay, so with the government support, so I dropped out from a developer and established my own business. And also in Hong Kong, there is some, I would say, is there anyone know what is an authorized person? Is there any authorized person practice here? An authorized person is that a person, usually an architect or an engineer or surveyor, they are registered and responsible for the development of the project. They are personally responsible. So all the joint submissions, all the joint records are certified by the authorized persons. So if there is any problem in the buildings, any problem during construction, the authorized person may sometimes put in jail, I don't know. But in Hong Kong, there is some practice note. So government issue many practice note for the authorized persons and try to encourage them to use the BIM. It is the practice note for the authorized persons. That it is a very big step in Hong Kong. That means in the building departments, they are accept the authorized person to use BIM now. This is just issue, I think, several months ago. Okay, and also in Hong Kong, we have a BIM standard. We developed a building information modeling standard, which is a standard document to govern how people can use BIM effectively. And I was the committee member of that. And every time I saw that, I think, why I'm so stupid to have my business at my own. It is so happy in the past to be a developer, employee. In Hong Kong, being an employee is better than being a sole proprietor. It's very, very risky, right? Okay, and in 2014, and I was a panel judge of the BIM Excellence Award in Hong Kong. And at the time they invited me to be a panel judge, I have already submitted my application to this award. And then they told me that, why don't you be a judge panel instead of an applicant? So I struggled for so many weeks. Whether I belong to the stage or whether I sit on the stage. and my advisor tell me, my friends tell me that you lose nothing when you are a judges panel, right? Anyway, but I prefer to be one of the applicants to this excellent award. They get all the awards and more happier than the judge panel, I would say. Okay, so I start my business and do a lot of projects on BIM, and the first one is at university dormitory, just like here. We commissioned by a contractor to help them to do a BIM model. And this is the BIM model for the M&E, all the pumping and drainage, all the electric. This is the pumping and drainage, everything. All the drainage, all the pumping, and all these coordinates and so on. Some are drawn by BIM. You can't believe that. The technology is so easy to adopt, and some of the model is actually produced by myself with just month of training. And this is the drawing for the CSD coordination, the combined services drawing coordinations. And this is the figures. And we do a lot of crack detection. We always mention crack detection in BIM. We try to find some human error by using the model. So we produce a lot of crack detection reports. We highlight what kind of thing is going wrong and tell the architect or the engineer to improve it. And we do a lot of visualization. We simulate the construction site. Can you see that? We simulate the construction site sequence by the model. It's moving so slowly. And I think there's no music at all, but I think I'm the one in Hong Kong that being a BIM simulation background music composer. It is so boring then to see the model and I mix up some music as the background. So the client is so happy to listen to music rather than see the animation. So you can open up your own career by your imaginations, right? So you see the model is so boring to see how the thing construct and how the tower frame is moving. So if you add some music, then I think it's more enjoyable. Anyway, it's a simulation for the model for how the construction works is going on. And your lecturer tell me that in Hong Kong, why people are still using bamboo scaffolding, right? I think Hong Kong is the only one city in the world. I can only say a city in the world. I don't know whether it's some rural area or some little town they use bamboo scaffolding in China. But even in China, people are not using bamboo scaffolding. It's the only place in the city in the world that use bamboo scaffolding in Hong Kong because of the low cost, because of the tradition, or because of its flexibility in using that and the speed. A lot of advantages, I would say. But in Malaysia, you don't use it, right? It's a metal scaffolding, right? So the green one is the metal, it's the bamboo scaffolding. Okay, then another one is the excavation sequence. We try to demonstrate how the basement is excavated. Is there any basement here? It's a basement here, right? In Hong Kong, there's a lot of basement. People try to maximize the usage of the land, they take a lot of space from one level and two levels. It should be a four level of basement. So we try to demonstrate to the client why you need a lot of scaffolding, why you need a lot of structure, why you need to do the basement totally. Okay, and the most important thing, most useful thing is we use the model to do all this taking off, the excavation volume, the structural steel. So it seems that we have nothing to do now, right? As I told this earlier. We do the modeling, we do the taking off. Okay, that's the some application from a company, some application of BIM in Hong Kong. And the second thing is about building environmental assessment method for the speed. It's another thing, we call it green building development. In Hong Kong actually there is only two or three pollutants. One is the traffic, right? Something from the traffic will pollute the city. Another one is the people call when you produce a building, when you use a building, you pollute the environment. That's true, because whenever a person neither in a building, they are traveling, right? It's actually so obvious. When you are not on the road, you are in the building. And people arguing that when you are in a playground, how about in a playground in open space, that is a part of the building, right? That is an annex of the building, that is attached to a building. So In Hong Kong, we try to deal with the pollution issue. We try to establish some standard in the green building development so that we try to minimize the pollution during construction and when the building is in use. So we have a professional green building council formed by some professional institutes, architect, engineer, and construction surveyors. And also we have green building council. We develop a green building standard by the green building council. And we established a BIM plus green building environmental assessment method by the council. And this is the green building award every 2 years. We have a green building award. This is some kind of green building outlook. And actually in Hong Kong, you can easily identify which is a green building. How you can identify which building is a green building? When you look at the photo, when you look at the brochure, it looks very nice, it's a green building. But actually when you walk in the building, you feel hot, dark, then it's a green building. Okay, very easy. Every time we go to a building, we feel hot and dark, then it's a green building. So very good in energy minimization, right? So, and also in green building, we're not only concerned on the new building, we're also concerned on the existing building. We virtualize some buildings. Okay, we try to give a new life to an old building. And also in some secondary school, they try to provide greenery at the top, and green top. And there is a green building award in 2014. And then I can identify myself here. Maybe this one is the right. I call the right guy. That is not me. I can't call it. We were there in 2016. So I was an organizing committee of one of these awards. So what is the BIM+ new building? Actually, it's a standard that covers the demolition planning, design, construction, and commission of the new building. They try to have a good practice for all these kind of things to become more green. They try to reduce wastage, more energy efficient design, particularly passive design. In Hong Kong, people are talking about passive design, but I think in Malaysia or Singapore, they do it very well. All the buildings facing south, all the buildings have higher headroom, so that it saves energy from the design, saves energy in the first place. And what building can be assessed is any kind of building can be assessed for the green building assessment. And the benefit of taking the assessment is a lot of things they said have benefit for green building assessment. And they did it very successfully in green building assessment for the new building. Do you know why they can persuade all the developers to invest for the green building development? Just because of one thing, very simple. If your building is classified or shown the green building assessment scheme, you can have 10% extra GFA exemption. You know what is the GFA exemption? That means your land can have more high crop ratio than 10% higher than the awarded than the government required governed GFA crop ratio. You know, when you can build 10,000 meter square, if you join the scheme, you can have 10% more. You can have 1,000 meter square more, right? So that is a very huge incentive for the developer. You know, the land is so expensive. When you saw the green building scheme, you can build more and sell more. And what are they? They assess the energy use, site aspect, indoor environmental quality, material aspect, water use, and innovation and additions. So people always misunderstand the green building when you paint the building in green or when you have more greenery in the green building. Actually, it is wrong. We try to identify that whether the energy use is reasonable, whether the site aspect is related to the energy saving, and the indoor environment quality is good enough, or the material aspect, water use, and do you have some innovation and additions for the green building? Is there any similar thing in Malaysia? It should be? Or the building here is already very green? I wish it run. You see, there is such a large, floor height lecture room which is already fulfilled the green building environment, the green building criteria, right? All the hot air coming up and all the cool air coming down. It's very good. But in Hong Kong, there's no such luxury, I think. In Hong Kong, the lecture room is a little bit higher than 3 meters, I would say, rather than 4 or 5 meters now. Very good. Okay, and you can get different rating, platinum, gold, silver, and bronze. And this is the existing building with a similar rating, similar method, similar assessment method. Okay, and also we have some statistics. Actually, you can see all this green building registered is residential. 40% is residential. In Hong Kong, all buildings are actually, in Hong Kong, most of the buildings are residential. People are lacking of residential housing. So the price of the housing is very, very high. And this is the number of assessed projects. And you can see this is the rating of the assessed project. People are willing to invest many money into the green building assessment. So over the half is better than gold, you know. If you take into account the gold rating, it's almost 75% close of the building will be at a rating in platinum, in gold, rather than in bronze or unclassified. So people in Hong Kong really like marketing, you know. If you join the scheme, if you get the bronze, your residential flat cannot be sold in high price. So if you join the scheme, why not you invest some money? Just a little bit money, you can promote your project. Okay, so why it is related to cottage area, why I can get involved in that? You can see the menu from the green building assessment scheme. A lot of things is about how much percentage, how to quantify something, how much green material you are using, how long is it a regional material, how much because concrete you are using. All these things are quantitative, quantifying, you know. As a content surveyor, we are easily to quantify the material, we are easily to classify the material in different ways. So this is a good opportunity for content surveyors to get involved in the green building, to get all this information, to do a cost-benefit analysis for your clients, whether we use the green material, we will have a benefit, whether the green material will save some cost or in the long run, in the life cycle costing, we will have a better performance than other material. So at that moment, so I get involved, I totally get involved in the green building assessment and help them to assess a lot of projects in Hong Kong. Okay, so after that, we talk about BIM, we talk about green building. Actually, risk management is nothing new. When people talking about risk management, people are talking about quantitative analysis, how to do mathematical model, how to do probability, right? People are talking about probability, how many percentage of accidents every year will be happen, a fatal accident in a car crash. But actually, risk management is a very I can't say it's simple, it's an embedded process in your business. When you do all kind of project management, all kind of business management, you need to have the risk management embedded in your process. So we always persuade our clients that is the risk management. We do the building information modeling for the design risk. We try to coordinate your design, we try to make your design complete by building a model, by checking of the model. And we try to save your building from environmental harm to have the BIM plus certification. And also the quantitative survey, right? The quantitative survey help you to do the financial management, financial risk management. And some quantitative surveyors answer me that they are not doing risk management. But actually quantitative surveying is, in a broad sense, is a financial risk management of the project, right? Yes, a quantitative surveyor, you try to reduce the risk of the project. Okay? So after that, that's all. And I won't talk about quantitative surveying at all because I just got a diploma. I do nothing about that. Not too much for it. I have some case theory. Some case theory of how my company or how myself to apply this technology, to apply this skill to different projects. Okay, the case theory number one, I think, I don't know whether you know what is a colloquium. I don't know. This is a Hong Kong special features. We try to put all cemetery in vertically, right? We put the cemetery vertically. That's called colloquium, okay? You may understand it. Okay, this is a colloquium. You can't imagine that. This is a colloquium. This looks like a very nice library and very nice building. This is a colloquium in Hong Kong and worth a lot of, it's worth a lot of, very high cost and selling. Just because people, this is the back, and this is the inside place. Very nice, just like a hotel, right? And you see this is the entrance and all this, all this colloquium is here. You know what it is? All the cemetery are here. It's vertically and people worship it and you know, visit it. So you can see this, when you see this is a square, little square here, we sell it by this little square. So when we take up this project, we all go to a temple to worship for life. because this is related to the dead people, I would say. This is what we are doing. We try to build a model for our service, for model building, for quantitative surveying. And this is some rendering from the project. Rendering, very nice. And we do the quantitative takeoff for the structural works. So it's very easy. When we build up the model, we just produce the schedule and quantities for the build of quantities. And this is, we also produce the built of quantity for the architectural work on the model. So when you are quantitative, you all are quantitative surveyors. When you see the building like this, I think you may have the panic that how we measure the facade, how we measure the quantity, how we measure the all kinds of things in the irregular shape. But if you got the technology, it's quite easy. So we save a lot of time for us. We take about 2 weeks to finish the build quantity and tender it out. And the second one is quite more interesting one is Robert Block. It's a heritage project. In Hong Kong, there is some revitalization of the historical building full practice. They try to use the business investment to revitalize some buildings. They frequently post up some buildings that invite people to collaborate together. So there is an old building in Hong Kong in 1900, 200 years before, right? 100 years before. It's a very, very old building. And it looks like this. It's a three-story building with a green roof, with a green color roof, and some trimming. So, we have received some drawing, we have received some 2D drawing, some layout drawing, 2D plan. This is an old plan, I would say. This is the plan they will produce after the building has completed, not the original one. The original one has been disappeared for many, many years. In the elevator drawing. And there's some architectural features. And they want to turn it into a music and play service. I think it's a good occupation. If you have time, you can quickly come this way and study that. Music and play service. That's everything you sing a song and play with children and we get paid, right? I've never heard that in Hong Kong, but they said, oh, this is very useful. I think when the course is completed, I would like to apply for an assistant music and pay for a piece for earning some easy money, right? It's better than doing a commuting job, right? They want to turn the old building into a music and play therapy center. They try to help the children through the music and play. And actually, I think children, when they have things together, playing together, they will be more happier. It's very easy, right? So it's very easy concept, simple concept. Okay, so at the time, we joined a voluntary team of people, and we start to talk about how we convert the building, convert the old building into a music and play therapy center. So we've got a lot of people, got a lot of professional people, and they all draw in paper. So they roll out a large paper and they, oh, we would like to have a lift tower, we would like to have some disabled staircase here and there. So at the time I joined the team, I tell them, this is not today, this is not up to today's technology level. I think it goes back to the 100 years before. We all have the meeting on the table with a piece of paper. So when I joined it, I voluntarily built the model by the reference 2017. We built the model first, right? We built a model for them. It's not like the photo, right? Similar to the photo. We build a model for them, this is the model, this is an existing building. And then we come back to the meeting. They said, oh, amazing, they match up. They think that we are really the expert. So, although I'm not the architect, I'm not the engineer, but they know that they get the right person. We are really the expert to help them. And then we add the staircase, right? We add the lift tower, we add the staircase for the building. It's not very nice. And after that, in different directions, the existing building, we add the lift tower and we add the disabled ramp, right? It's not very nice with the building information modeling. So, you know, our purpose is trying to do a proposal to the authority, to the panel members of the government. They know nothing about construction, they don't know nothing about drawing. If you submit the proposal by the 2D drawings, they just like this, right? A lot of unknown things, right? So we try to help them by doing this model and submit to the panel. If you are the panel member, if you are not the construction professional, they will be more happier and you can get the project more easier. And then, actually the project is not, when you see this drawing, you can see the problem of the problem of the project. Actually, you see that, oh, just the project. You see that this is the project is in the hillside. You can see that there's only an access road here, an access staircase here. You can walk along the staircase to come to the project. And this is all in 2D, right? You can't aware that's the problem. But when we draw the BIM model, we tell the panel what is the problem of the project. You can build the staircase, you can build the disabled ramp, and you can do some interior renovations. But you have to have a car lay by there, right? You have to have car park. In Hong Kong, we call it emergency vehicle access. We have to let the fireman vehicle to stop on the site and then go to the site for firefighting. So we have to do it, and then we have to do some soil nail to stabilize the slope. I think in Malaysia, people will not spend money to do so, right? In Hong Kong, people waste a lot of money to stabilize the slope. Okay, why we need to stabilize? Because we have no land at all. Okay, and then still need to build the lift tower, link bridge. That is the problem of the project. You know, after we have drawn all these things, the original staircase in there. Okay, and submit to the panel, they all realize that the problem of the project. Originally, why the building is not used, it become an outdated or become an obsolete historical building because of the asset. Because people cannot access to them, it is not up to the today asset, particularly from the stable, they can't go into the building. So we need to build the lift, we need to build, stabilize the slope, and build the lift tower, and build the plane bridge. And then all these costs are larger than the building itself, right? Stabilize the slope, build the lift tower, and build the plane bridge. So after that, we submit a proposal based on the BIM model. And also, we use all this information, we turn all the 2D floor layout plans into 3D for the council to understand it. All this are 3D. And we use the BIM model, this is the drawing produced by the BIM model, not drawn by the AutoCAD, okay? By the BIS model. Okay, we can have all this area schedule, we have all this taking off quantity by the BIM model for different floor to facilitate us to do the final one, the easy one, the cost estimate, right? So we do the model for the council and we do the estimate for them so that we can submit our proposal to them. So do you think it's more easier to get approved by the council? I think so. I think all these council members being a government council member, they just don't know construction, right? But they need to approve your project. So we need to have a means that we can communicate to each other and so that they can understand it. So and also we use the BIM model and we can target the three buildings, the location, the spectrum, in the highest standard. And you can see that it is a very good, I think it is a very good presentation if you can do an animation by the BIM model to let them know what we are doing, right? And we make a mistake. I think in Hong Kong there is no red tree here. I think nobody noticed that. Okay, anyway. Okay, so we talked about BIM, it seems that very powerful in Hong Kong and very, very useful, but actually there is some issue in Hong Kong. In Hong Kong, there is some problem in implementing BIM. So the first issue is about people, about county surveyors, I think, about county surveyors. Most county surveyors trained to be writing, good at writing skills, right? They're good at writing something bulletproof. I don't know what it means, bulletproof. When the client instructs you to adopt BIM, small quantity surveyors write a contract like this, the application of BIM model shall be at the risk of the contractors, and no claim or whatever arising out of the discrepancy, error, or omission due to inaccurate information or particular in the BIM model will be allowed. It's always happened in Hong Kong. So I do not hope that it will happen in Malaysia. Okay, when you use the BIM, that is not at the own risk of the contractors, right? BIM produces a very good collaboration tool to share information within the project team. So, if you are the content surveyor, I hope that you don't treat it as a very, very horrible thing that we put all the risk to the contractors. We should have something to write it better, share the risk and how to allocate the risk between the project team. So in UK, we have NEC3 contract, right? NEC contract has a how to use BIM supplement. There is a use BIM with NEC contract. So there is something that guides people to use the BIM with the NEC contract. Rather than just writing at the own risk of the contract, I think it's no good enough. And then we have JCC supplement for BIM, right? JCC contract in UK, they have a supplement for BIM, and they have a public sector supplement for fair payment, transparency, and building information modeling. They purposely write something to help people to implement BIM with the contract conditions. And also in Singapore, in the nearby city, they have a BIM particular condition. Okay, all these things are very nice and well written, but in Hong Kong there is no such thing. In Hong Kong, people are still using traditional standard form contract in Hong Kong and also writing the BIM clause like this. Okay? okay, it's horrible. How come a contractor can put all the risk for using BIM, right? A contractor is just receiving your information. If I receive the 2D drawing from the architect, if the drawing is wrong, the contractor can take for loss and expenses.